Hello friends, welcome to Pioneer of Success, an online free educational institute. So we are continuing with the chemistry series, and today we will be discussing on bore radius and energy calculation for different bore shells. So this is the part 2 video of atomic structure. We have already uploaded the part 1 video. If you haven't seen yet, kindly visit our playlist and you will get the part 1 video. So this video is helpful for WBCS main chemistry preparation, WBJE, JE mains and medical entrance examination. And if you are preparing for your college chemistry, then also this video is going to help you. So before going into details, let me tell you something about myself. So I am Shishanu Mitro, a research scholar of Indian Institute of Technology, Guwahati. And those are my email IDs. If you have any queries, you can write me emails. So I have completed BS in chemistry from University of Calcutta, then BTech in chemical engineering from the same university, and now pursuing research. So now let us proceed with the topic. Before starting the derivation, I will tell you the basic things of Bohr model. So Bohr model is only valid for monoelectronic atom. That means the atoms which have only one electron in its outermost shell, that for them we can apply Bohr model. And one more thing, electron can revolve in shell where angular momentum mvr is integer multiples of h by 2 pi. That is the basic criterion of Bohr. That is the postulate of Bohr model. So this is actually hydrogen atom. In the nucleus we have only one proton. This is the nucleus of the hydrogen atom, only one proton, and this is the outermost shell where only one electron is revolving. So we would calculate the radius of this shell as well as the energy of the electron residing in this shell. So how to calculate the radius? Radius means this distance is called radius, r, denoted by r. So there are basically two forces balancing each other. There is an electron which is rotating around the nucleus. An electron has some mass. Now as it has some mass, then what would happen when it rotates? It would have some centrifugal force, and that centrifugal force is given by mv square by r. So this is the centrifugal force, and it acts outward in outer direction. This arrow is showing that only. And other force is acting because of the attraction between two charges. So here there is one proton having positive charge and electron having negative charge. So they are attracting each other, and because of the attraction one force is acting, and that is called Coulombic force of attraction. Now in equilibrium, these two forces are equal. That is a force for Coulombic attraction and force for centrifugal. These two forces are equal. If the forces are balancing each other, then only the electron would stay in this shell. Otherwise, if this force is higher, then it would tend to go outward. And if this force is higher, then it would tend to come in this direction. So we can say that when the electron is revolving in a particular shell, then these two forces are balancing each other. Now I will show you. So this is the centrifugal force. The magnitude is mv square by r. I have already shown you. And you have Coulombic force of attraction, that is given by z e square by r square. Now why it is z e square by r square, I will tell you. Suppose the atomic number is z. Now how many proton are there? There are z number of protons, and protons have positive charge. Now charge of proton and electron is equal. So what I can say, z protons have ze charge, total ze charge, because each atom has e charge, each electron or proton has e charge, so total ze charge. Now this ze is for the nucleus, and one more is there in the shell, that is the electron. So this is positive, this is negative. They are attracting, and this attraction force is z e square by r square. This negative sign is coming because if this is positive, that is negative. That's why multiplication of positive and negative is negative. So this is the Coulombic force, and you know Coulombic force is equal to q1 q2 by r square. So I told you Q1 is equal to ZE and Q2 equal to E and R equal to R. That's why ZE square by R square. Now what we are doing? We are balancing these two forces. These two forces are mb square by R and ZE square by R square. So we balance these two forces. One R can be cancelled, and from there we can calculate the value of R. So here R is mb square R square by ZE square. Now what we can do? We can multiply by m in the numerator and denominator. It was mb square R square by ZE square. Now if we multiply by 1m in both the numerator and denominator, then we will get m square v square r square by m z e square. Now m square v square r square means mvr whole square. And again, you know from the Bohr's theory, mvr equal to what? Mvr equal to nh by 2 pi. Then mvr whole square will be equal to n square h square by 4 pi square. That is square of this thing that we have done here. Yeah, mvr equal to nh by 2 pi. So after replacing this mvr square, we are getting r equal to n square a square by 4 pi square m square z. So you note it down. So this is the radius of a Bohr shell. Now for the first shell, your n equal to 1, and at the same time as we are calculating for hydrogen atom or any mono electronic atom, that means Z capital Z equal to 1. So we replace N equal to 1 and Z equal to 1, and we are getting H square 4 pi square M E square. Now all the things are known. H, Planck constant, the value we know. M means mass of electron, we know the value. E means charge of electron, we know the value. If we put all the value and if we calculate, it would come around 0.529 angstrom. So that is the radius of first Bohr shell. So that might be a MCQ question. So this number you should remember, 0.529 angstrom. Angstrom means 10 to the power minus 8 centimeter, means 1 angstrom. Okay, so now if we want to calculate radius for second, third shell. So this one is for the, say this is the nucleus, and this radius is the for first shell R1. Now we have many shells R2 R3 R4. If we want to calculate R2 R3 R4, then we cannot put n equal to 1, then we have to retain n, and in general it is coming R equal to n square a0 by z. Okay, so we have completed the radius calculation. Now we are bothered about the energy. Now first thing you should remember, whenever you are calculating energy, then you have to sum up all the contributing energy terms. Now what are the contributing energy terms here? Here the terms are potential energy and kinetic energy. If you want to calculate energy of an electron, you have to sum up potential plus kinetic energy. Now what is the potential energy? The potential energy is given by minus Z square by R. Now how to calculate that? What is the definition of potential energy? Let me explain. So I told there is one proton at the center and one electron in the shell, and there is a Coulombic force of attraction. And potential energy means the amount of work has to be done in order to take this electron to the infinite, the amount of work done, that is called your potential energy. Now how to calculate that one? That is integral of R to infinite, because we are taking the material from R distance to infinite distance. Now integrand is F into dr. Okay, now what is F? I have already told F is ZE, and here is, it is also E. So ZE square by R square, ZE square by R square is the force into dr. If you carry out this integration and put the limits, you will get this value. So I think it's clear where from this potential energy is coming. So thereby you get the potential energy, and now we are bothered about the kinetic energy. And kinetic energy is given by half mv square by the time we all know. So this is the kinetic energy term. Actually this E is the total energy. We have contributed the potential as well. So kinetic energy is given by mv square equal to z e square by r. Where from we are getting it? If you can remember, initially we balanced it. There were two forces. One is mv square by r centrifugal force, and that was being balanced by coulombic force z square by r square. So from this equation we can have mv square equal to z square by r. Okay, so we calculate mv square. Therefrom we can calculate half mv square. It will be just multiplied by half, and now we are just summing these two things. If we sum it up, we are getting minus z square by 2r. Now if you can remember, we have already calculated the value of r, that is the Bohr radius. Now we have to replace this r here. If we replace this r in this equation from the previous equation, we will get this form. This is the energy of Bohr shell, and this is given by minus 2 pi square m z square e to the power 4 n square a square. So these two things, radius and energy, you have to mug up, because question may arise from this radius and energy. Now from examination point of view, this equation would be required for your spectra calculation. What is spectra? Basically there are different shells of atom. Different shells means there is nucleus. Suppose one electron is placed in hydrogen atom, but the shells are free. So if we excite this electron, it can go to the higher energy state. So this is k equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, likewise it would be continuing. This is a principal quantum number. So when electron jumps from this or this shell to the above shell, after jumping, it would again come back to the initial position, that is the ground state. And when it comes back, it gives some energy, it releases some energy in the form of electromagnetic wave. And that electromagnetic wave is nothing but the spectra. And this transition is called quantum mechanical transition. What does it mean? Quantum mechanical transition means there are certain quantized state. That means, suppose this is k equal to 1, k equal to 2, principal quantum number equal to 1, 2, 3. But in between 1 and 2, there is no state. So electron would either stay here or here. There is no possibility of staying electron in between these two. This concept is called quantum mechanical concept. Okay. Now, let me tell you few things. So here what we did, we have given the difference of energy of two states. Suppose this is the two quantum numbers, the two shells. We know the energy of this state and this state, and the difference would be delta E equal to E final minus E initial. How to calculate that? By the time we know the energy from the equation we have already derived, so from that we can calculate delta E, and we know delta E equal to H nu. Delta E or E equal to H nu. Nu is the frequency, and we know another equation, velocity of the light equal to frequency into lambda. So if we replace, we can also get the wavelength of the radiation. So from there we will be calculating the frequency, radio wavelength and wave number. All the things can be calculated. So this is the equation for wave number. A few more things I should tell you. Suppose there are many shells, 1, 2, 3, 4. Now this electron can go to this shell, it can go to that shell, it can possibly go to all the higher shells. Now when it comes back to this one state, from where doesn't matter. If it comes back to state 1, it is called Lyman series. Now if it comes from the next immediate shell, then it is called Lyman alpha series. if it comes back to this, from this shell, it will be called a Lyman beta. And again, if it comes back from this shell, it will be called Lyman gamma echo, and so on. Then, if the electron comes to this second shell, then it is called Bummer series. If it comes from this immediate Bummer alpha, Bummer beta, from here this Bummer beta, and likewise. Then, if it comes back to this shell, it is called Bastian series, likewise Bracket series, Pond series. So, you have so many electronic series. So, we will be making a separate video on hydrogen spectra where we will be discussed. We will discuss in detail, but for the time being, this much is enough, I guess. So in this video, this is done. So please subscribe to my channel. If you like my video, please share it on social media and write in the comment section so that I make more videos. Thank you very much.